Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Monday night Bible study. Glad you're here. Glad you've joined us online. We're so glad that you're here. And as my dad used to say, how many of you would rather be here than in jail? That's everybody here, I hope. So it's good to be back from Africa, to be at Monday night Bible study. So it's good to be back with you. So before we get started, I wanted to share something funny that happened to me Saturday night. So I'll go into O'Reilly's auto parts store to pick up something with my son, a part he needed for his car. And so I walk in there, and this really nice gentleman came up to me, young man, and he said, "How can I help you?" And I said, "I'm looking for this," and he directed me right toward it. And then all of a sudden, he did this. He goes, "One eye like that," and he goes, "I know you." It's like that. I go, "Okay." And then he did it again. He tilted his head and he closed his eye. He said, "I know you." I said, "Okay." He said, "I used to go to the old church at Northeast Houston." I said, "Okay." He said, "You sound just like him." I said, "Okay, who am I?" He said, "You're Joel Osteen's father." So I took my business to Napa next door. I will never go in O'Reilly's again. I'm just kidding. I bought it at O'Reilly's, so. My son was mortified. So tonight we're going to start a new series on the first letter that Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, 1 Corinthians. I think it's going to be a fun study. It's going to be a kind of a long study. We're going to take it almost chapter by chapter. But tonight, what I'd like to do is just lay a foundation of the history and the culture and the geography of Corinth, because I really think, as I've been studying this over the last several days, I think it really helps me understand what the Corinthians were struggling with, what they'd come out of, what they were having to resist going back into. And so I hope that, you know, that this foundation tonight will be really good for the upcoming weeks. I want to especially thank Pastor David Whiting of New Heights Church in Washington State. I was looking at a video he did on YouTube, and David, if you ever watch this, it's a fabulous YouTube on ancient Corinth, and he had some maps in there, and I called him up in Washington State, and he said we could use those maps. So thank you, David, for allowing me to do that. All right, so let's start with a word of prayer. Can we do that? If it's easy for you to grab hands with somebody, do that. Lord, thank you for this evening. Lord, thank you for breath in our lungs. Thank you for health and strength. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for Jesus, for the cross, for the resurrection. Thank you for the Holy Spirit who indwells in us and leads us and guides us and directs us. Thank you for the fact, Father, that you're a good Father and that you're a loving Father and you're a kind Father. And Father, you have good plans for us and not evil. And Father, we thank you that we get to serve and be a part of the family of a good, good Father and a good, good God. Thank you for that, Father. Father, we just pray for the people on our right and left. We don't know what they're going through, Father, but you do, because you're a good shepherd and you know the condition of your sheep. So Father, we pray for that person on the right and the left, that you would bless, that you would encourage the people that are watching tonight by internet. Father, just bless them, encourage them, strengthen them. Father, those that need healing, heal them. Those that are struggling with depression, Father, just loose those bondages of depression. Father, those that are down and discouraged, lift them up, Father. Those that are, Lord, just struggling with grief, comfort them. Those that feel alone, Father, may they know they're not alone, that you're with them. And Father, whatever they need, Father, I pray that even now the healing virtue of Jesus would flow out of my brothers and sisters into their person they're holding hands with, the people on the watching online. And Father, you would do what only you can do. You would heal, touch, deliver, comfort, strengthen, and do what you do best, Father. Do miracles, Father. Tonight, Lord, as we start this series, we pray that you would just quiet our hearts, even as Joel talked about yesterday, that we would unclutter our minds, and as children, that we would sit at your feet, and that we would simply listen not to Paul speaking, but to the Holy Spirit talking and revealing you to us, Lord, because we want to see you better so that we can be more like you. We pray that in the name of Jesus, and everybody said amen. So the author of the letter to the 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians is Paul the Apostle. We all know Paul the Apostle, but I want to contextualize something for you because I read this week and I think that really helped me. Paul was raised in Tarsus, which is now modern-day Turkey, but it was one of the centers of Greek or what's called Hellenistic culture at that time. So he understood Greek mythology, understood the Greek gods. He understood the mysticism that went with that particular culture. And then he was also raised in a very devoutly Orthodox Jewish family. And he was sent to study at a young age, probably to Jerusalem under a teacher of the law, very respected, highly respected and esteemed teacher of the law by the name of Gamaliel. And he was trained in the Pharisaic line of teaching. So he was a Pharisee. So he was raised in Tarsus in the Greek culture. He was raised in a devoutly Jewish culture. But he was also something else rare for a Jewish man. He was a Roman citizen. Somehow his father had arranged for them to have a citizenship in Rome. So he was also well acquainted with Roman law and Roman culture. So Paul knew what it meant to be a Jew. He knew what it meant to be a Greek. And he knew what it meant to be a Roman citizen. And that's very important as you understand the culture of the city of Corinth that we'll talk about today. The letter that Paul wrote is addressed to the church at Corinth. Now, this church was established by Paul during his second missionary journey. I'll show you a map in a minute. But it's 18 years. It was in the year 51 AD. So if Jesus died in 33 AD, roughly, this is basically 18 years after Jesus ascended and went to heaven. And also, most people think 18 years after Paul was saved on the road to Damascus. So We get a little bit of insight into the founding of this church, establishment of this church in Acts 18. So if everybody can turn over to Acts 18, we can read that together. Starting in the first verse, and this is about the founding of the church of Corinth. After this, Paul left Athens and he went to Corinth. There he met a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had ordered all the Jews to leave Rome. Paul went to see them, and because he was a tent maker, everybody say tent maker, as they were. So Paul was a tent maker like Priscilla and Aquila were. He stayed and he worked with them. Every Sabbath, Paul reasoned in the synagogue, trying to persuade the Jews and the Greeks. When Silas and Timothy came from Macedonia, Paul devoted himself exclusively to preaching, testifying to the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah. But when they opposed Paul and became abusive, he shook out his clothes in protest and said to them, "Your blood be on your own heads. I am innocent of it. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles." Then Paul left the synagogue and went next door to the house of Titius Justus, a worshiper of God. Crispus, the synagogue leader, and his entire household believed in the Lord, a Jewish man. And many of the Corinthians, non-Jewish, the many of the Corinthians who had heard Paul believed and were baptized. One night, now this is a really kind of sweet passage that we'll refer to later. One night the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. He said, "Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent, for I am with you. And no one is going to attack and harm you, because I have many people in this city." Isn't that beautiful? And I'm going to paint a picture of the city in a few minutes. So you're going to think, why would God have people in this city? But he says, "I have many people in this city." So Paul stayed at Corinth for a year and a half, teaching them the word of God. When Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews of Corinth made a united attack on Paul and brought him to the place of judgment. Everybody say, place of judgment. We'll refer to this in a minute as well. That this man, they charged, is persuading the people of God to worship in ways that are contrary to the law. Just as Paul was about to speak, Gallio said to them, "If you Jews were making a complaint about some misdemeanor or serious crime, it would be reasonable for me to listen to you. But since it involves questions about words and names in your own law, settle the matter yourselves. I will not be a judge of such things." So he drove them off. Then the crowd turned on Sosthenes, the synagogue leader, and beat him in front of the proconsul, and Gallio showed no concern whatsoever. Keep reading on I think it's the next verse, 18 or 19. Paul stayed on at Corinth for some time. Then he left the believers and sailed for Syria, accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. So there you see the beginnings of the church at Corinth. Paul is on his second missionary journey. He begins teaching and preaching. The Jewish people reject him. He then goes to next door to house churches, as we learn later, and he begins to a 1.5 year ministry right there in Corinth. And then at some time, well, basically, I did say this too. Think about this. Paul was showing these new Corinthian believers what it meant to leave their old life and to become a follower of Jesus and to begin to experience this new life that he had for them. He was pastoring them. And then according to Acts 19:1, you can read it later, Apollos also came to Corinth. So we know that Paul was there for 1.5 years and then Apollos came to Corinth. And then there's debate historically whether Peter came, but most scholars think that Peter must have come to Corinth as well, because in next week when we start talking about this, they were already divided into factions. One was saying, I follow Paul, I follow Apollos, and I follow Peter. So it's obvious that all three of them had influence there, and certainly Paul and Apollos came, and probably so did Peter. There were thought to be about 40 to 150 members of this church. Most people think it was more around 100. Of course, nobody knows for sure, but it wasn't a huge, huge movement, because otherwise I think it would have said that in the scripture. And after 1.5 years, Paul left Corinth and he went to Ephesus. And then later, I think it was probably 2 years later, he got word that this church that he had started there in Corinth was having problems. As a matter of fact, a lot of people say things were falling apart in the church. And really, when you look at what he addresses here, things were really in a tough situation. The people were struggling. And so he wrote this letter in response to some of the things that he heard were going on at Corinth. And he probably wrote this 2 years after he left Corinth, or probably in about 55 AD. Now, a couple of things I'll tell you about this letter. It's the longest letter in the New Testament. It has 16 chapters. And it's interesting, there's 1st and 2nd Corinthians, 1st and 2nd letters that Paul wrote to the Corinthian church. But scholars think that there were two other letters that have been lost, or at least were not included in the canon or the Bible as we know it. And this is clearly a letter of pastoral exhortation and pastoral correction. Paul has serious concerns about the church, and you can tell when we start next week, he jumps right into it right after his greeting. He is strong, he is clear, he's uncompromising as he addresses the issues that he sees as serious to the threatening the life of this church. But he's also, he's uncompromising, he's serious, he's tough, but he also has a pastor's kind and tender heart. I'm sure he's reteaching some of the things that he'd already taught them, and now they've kind of gone back into their old way of life. And Paul does this with firmness, but he also does it with kindness. He's helping them address issues that he knows are going to hold them back from being everything that God wants them to be. Like a parent that's correcting a child. You know what? No matter how many times they fall down trying to learn to ride a bicycle, how many of you know you don't quit? You just keep getting them back up. And I love what my dad used to say. Daddy said, God didn't make failures. He made learners. And so if you look at this past, this letter, you know, Paul is correcting them. But when you see what they came out of, they're just still learning. They're new in their faith, 1 year, 2 years into their faith. So they're still learning. And so Paul's is just like a father or a mother correcting their child, not giving up on them, just keep correcting them and helping them to learn. As a matter of fact, I want you to flip over to 1 Corinthians 4:14, because I think it says beautifully exactly what I was trying to say there. This is Paul talking, 1 Corinthians 4:14, and he says this, I am writing this not to shame you, but to warn you as my dear children. Even if you had 10,000 guardians in Christ, you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I became your father through the gospel. Therefore, I urge you to imitate me. So you can see the kindness that Paul has toward the people of Corinth. I think the beauty of this letter, too, is that it offers us a glimpse into the early years of a brand new church. And I can tell you that having been here for 20 years and been in pastoral ministry, and I'm sure if I ask my mom who's been here, how many years now, Mom? 60 years. The same problems the Corinthian church faced way back then are the same problems, in essence, that we all face today. They're no different problems. Paul's words are just as relevant and just as applicable and just as meaningful for us today as they were back then. Because how many of you know that the church isn't a museum of perfect people? Amen? If you're perfect, you can step out the door right now because you're lying. We know that. But it's not, there are no perfect people. There are no perfect churches. As people come out of the world and embrace a new faith in Jesus, they don't immediately have perfect behavior. Amen? And how many of you know sometimes it's easy to go back to the old way? That's why you need pastors to help you. My dad was a master at that. Joel's a master at that. Just encouraging to come back and get back up no matter how many times you fall. So remember that no perfect people, no perfect churches. And as people come out of the world, you know what? Their behavior doesn't immediately change. How many of you struggle with things for years before God gave you grace to change it? You know, sometimes things fall off just like that, but sometimes you struggle with things until God gives you the grace to get over them. Amen? So it's good to just remember that. And the other thing I want you to remember, well, I will pose this as a question, but I don't want to embarrass anybody. Do you know that there was no Bible for them to read? How many of you knew that? They didn't have a Bible. First, James was written in 50 AD, and this is just 51, so it wasn't circulated. So there was no Bible for them to read. There were no churches for them to pattern themselves or model themselves after. I was thinking I'd get this magazine called Outreach Magazine, and there are probably 100 church growth conferences that I could go to this year. Think about that. This was early in the Christian faith, and this was a brand new church and a brand new endeavor called Christianity. And so this was all new to them. It's not like they could go back and say, well, it says here in Galatians, there was no Bible per se. Paul addresses some things that are really important even today. He addresses factions and divisions. He addresses morals that had degenerated. He addresses marriage. He addresses worship that had become chaotic and selfish. He addresses the Lord's Supper that really wasn't being handled correctly, and Jesus kind of came to him, and Paul talks about how Jesus revealed how the Lord's Supper was to be taken. And then he strongly corrects some error in their teaching or in their understanding, specifically about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and also the resurrection of the dead. So these are the things that we'll address over the next few weeks. I like this book because it's beautiful. You know, 1 Corinthians 13, everybody knows that. Love is patient, kind, wonderful. But then there's also some very difficult passages in 1 Corinthians. And so we're anxious and looking forward to unpacking those. You know, the women's role in church, covering your head, a lot of things like that that we'll talk about. But that's basically just kind of the introduction. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the city of Corinth, because I think really if you want to paint a picture, you have to see the backdrop of, you know, this is who that Corinthian church was. And in order to really understand the Corinthian church, you really have to understand the city of Corinth. I didn't know a lot of this stuff until I started reading and studying it over the last couple of weeks, but Corinth was one of the most important cities in the ancient world. And almost always, when I think of Greece, I always think of Athens. And Athens was important, but this was one of the most important cities in the ancient world and probably one of the greatest Roman cities in the world. It's located, we'll talk about this, at one of the most important crossroads of the Roman world. Corinth, just by history, long history before 146 BC, but in 146 BC, the Romans absolutely just decimated the city. They killed all the men, all the women and the children were taken as slaves, and the place was left isolated and unpopulated for almost 100 years. In 46 AD, Julius Caesar gave the edict to rebuild Rome, rebuilt the city as a Roman colony. He died long before that was done. But in 46 AD, they began to, 46 BC, I should say, Julius Caesar began to reconstruct Rome. Not only did they build the city, but Roman veterans, the people that had fought in Roman wars, Julius Caesar gave them land in Corinth. So there were a lot of Roman citizens there. And then some of the Greeks, when they realized that the city was being rebuilt, some of the Greeks came back into that area. And then there were a lot of immigrants from all over the Mediterranean and Asia. We'll show pictures in a minute. Even from Egypt and North Africa, they all kind of came together there, immigrated into this population there at Corinth. And we do know that there was part of the Jewish diaspora there because there was a synagogue there. The Jews were driven out of a lot of different places, and we know that there was a synagogue there. That's even been found archaeologically within the last 100 years that there was, confirmed the fact that there was a synagogue in Corinth. So at the time Paul arrived, 51 AD, that means that Corinth was about 100 years old. So it's not a new city, but it's really not an old city either. It had a population of about 100,000 people. So let's just remember that in a few minutes when we talk about the size of the church. And surprisingly to me, Corinth was 5 times bigger than Athens. So I thought Athens was massive and Corinth was small, but it was just the opposite. It was 5 times bigger than Athens. Rome was built, I think I have a slide coming up. It was built in the Roman style. You can't really see a lot of this, but it has a Roman forum or gathering place for people to gather and to talk. That's where we get the word having a forum for us to talk. It also has agora. You can see the agora right here. I think you see it right there. That's agora. And these are just shops that line the edges of the gathering place there. And these are markets, much like our Galleria. And they've excavated 44 shops, but there were a lot more shops around there. So that was the agora. And then they had something called the bema seat right there. And the bema seat is really important because it's referred to several times in the New Testament. And Paul probably got the idea for the bema seat from probably his time here in Corinth. Because the bema seat is where the proconsul would sit, like the passage that we read just a few minutes ago. And he would just observe what was going on in the forum and in the agora. And then also, it's a place where at the bema that the authorities would give out commendations. And that's something you really wanted from Rome. You wanted commendations for efforts and what you've been doing. So it was a place of observation. It was a place of commendation. But it was also a place of condemnation, where somebody could be, like Paul, could have been sentenced at the bema seat. Now, why that's important, let's just flip over to 2 Corinthians 5, 9 and 10. Just to kind of give you an idea of how this paints into the letters that Paul wrote. So this is 1 Corinthians 9 and 10. So we make it our goal to please Jesus, whether we are at home in the body or away from it, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive what is due them for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. And that's the exact word there of bema that Paul uses. It also had an amphitheater that seated about 18,000 people. It also had stadiums for games and things of that nature. So it was a very cosmopolitan place. Second thing about Corinth is that it was in a very strategic location. In certain ways, its geography made it prosperous. Let me show you a couple pictures here. So I didn't know a lot of this, so let me just kind of refresh your memory. So this is Macedonia, this is Asia Minor. Israel's going to be right there, and Italy's going to be here. You'll see this mentioned in the Bible, Achaia, and that's what the Romans call this area here. And this is where Athens is going to be right there, and notice where Corinth is. Corinth is located right here in that isthmus right there in what's called Achaia, or now Greece. And could I have the next slide too? So this is a really nice thing that I thought would help you guys. This is Paul's second missionary journey. Let me just point out some things here. First off, Israel's down here. But if you look right here, that's where Paul was raised, Tarsus. And then if you go right here, anybody see Damascus? There's Damascus. There's where he had his Damascus Road experience. And then when you come over here, you see a lot of the places that you've heard. Ephesians, Philippians is in there somewhere. I can't quite see it. Philippians, Philippi is right here. Colossae's in there. Thessalonica's right here. So this is really kind of just the second missionary journey of Paul. And a lot of the places that he visits, he then writes letters to, and that's where we get the Galatians and the Philippians and the Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians. But then he swings all the way down here to Athens, and then he leaves Athens and comes to Corinth, and Corinth is right there. So that's kind of Paul's second missionary journey. What I want you to see, though, in the next slide is that Corinth was really a gateway between two seas. See this right here? This is the Aegean Sea, and this is, I think, the Ionian Sea. I think that's right. Italy is right here. So if you wanted to get through, you could either go around here or you could go across here. Now, there was no waterway to get through there. Next slide, please. This shows what it does. It connects the Aegean Sea with the Adriatic Sea and Rome over here. Basically, Corinth was a gateway. Can you go back two slides, please? Corinth was a gateway. One more, if you don't mind. Go forward. Forget it. Okay. But it was a gateway. Here it is. There it is right there. Yeah. It was a gateway between lower Greece called Peloponnese and upper Greece. So it was a gateway to connect Greece, but it was also a gateway to connect east and west travel. And let me show you the way they did that. Next slide, please. At each side of Corinth, this is a 4 mile width of land here. On each side, there's a city, a little city here. On one side, it's called Lycaeum, and the other side, it's called Cenchreae. And between those two cities, what would happen, could I have the next slide, please? This shows Cenchreae. This Phoebe, I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a deacon in the church of Cenchreae. She was in one of those port cities. Next slide, please. What would happen is that in order to sail around the southern Peloponnese there, it was very, very dangerous. There were bad currents, there were bad winds, there were bad storms, and it was very dangerous, and there were a lot of shipwrecks here. So in order to avoid shipwrecks and losing your cargo, what people would do is they would come up to Corinth, and they would take their cargo out of the ships, take it across that four-mile bridge, land bridge, and then load it into other ships and take it on to Italy. I like what one man said. I think it's up there for you. I have a quote. It says, "If sailors pass the southern tip twice, they ought to forget their homes." Meaning, you might make it once, but you're probably going to be dead the second time you do it. So it shows that Corinth was just a natural place so that people so that cargo could go through. Let me show you a picture of how they did it. Here's these guys. They've loaded this boat on this very ingenious tram they have here, and they'll actually pull it from one side four miles across and launch it in the other side. Here's another picture of the same thing. There they are in this sophisticated kind of tram-like thing, load a small ship up, and they'll actually take the ship across as well. Now, why do I say all that? I say that to say Corinth was a center of trade and commerce and manufacturing. And it's where everybody wanted to go in order to get to Rome. Lots of sailors, lots of merchants, lots of craftsmen, business people, lots of slaves to do all the work on the ships. It was a very wealthy city. It was a place that was known for its individualism and its competitive culture. People knew that they could make something of themselves there. As a matter of fact, slaves could gain their freedom and then go on to become wealthy people there. So it was known as a place that you could make a name for yourself. So I want you to get a thought of this busy metropolitan area of trade and commerce. As a matter of fact, it reminds me a lot of Houston, Port City. You know, a lot of manufacturing, a lot of stuff going on. Corinth was also known for the Isthmian Games. Now, Isthmia is a small town not far from there. And the Isthmian Games were second only to the Olympic Games, and they were held every other year. Athletes took a vow that they would abide by the rules or else they would be disqualified. And the winner of the Isthmian Games received a wreath. And what they would do is they would take wild celery, they would weave the stalks together, and they would make this crown that they would put on the winner, designating first place. Think about that now. How long do you think a celery stalk crown will last? Think about that. You can't even hang it on your wall for more than 24 hours, probably. It'll wilt and spoil and have to be discarded. As a matter of fact, I have a picture of that, I think. I found a picture. So this is a sculpture, and that's a depiction of that celery wreath crown for the winner of the Isthmian Games. Now, we do know from the time that Paul was there during one of the Isthmian Games, during the year and a half that Paul was there. So he witnessed them firsthand. Don't know if he ever witnessed an Olympic Games, but we know he witnessed these, or at least he was in the city when that was going on. Interestingly, there were no permanent houses or shelters for the athletes or for all the probably thousands of people that would come in for those games. What do you think they needed for shelter? They needed tents. And that's exactly what Priscilla and Aquila and Paul did. Tent making would be very, needed during that period of time. But I say all that to say, I want you to read 1 Corinthians 9. We'll come back and study this later, but turn over to 1 Corinthians 9, 24. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, like a sorry wreath. But we do it. How many of you know we're serving Jesus for a crown that will last? That will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it a slave to me so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. So there you see Paul talking very clearly about almost a direct reference to being disqualified and a wreath and a crown that won't last. So Corinth was home to the Isthmian Games every other year or every second year. Number four, Corinth was also a melting pot of peoples and cultures, a cosmopolitan city with mixed populations of Romans, of Greeks, of Jews, of Asians, and of a lot of other people from around the Mediterranean. So a lot of different ethnicities, a lot of different cultures. Every social class was represented, according to scholars, there in Corinth. In other words, you had very wealthy people, ship owners, business people that had made it big, influential people in the Roman government, and then you have poor and dispossessed or displaced people there, probably just immigrating, trying to escape or make a better life for themselves. And also, we know that there were several thousand slaves that were there. So every social class that could be imaginable, and we know, and we'll study this next week, is every one of those social classes were represented in the Church of Corinth. Slaves are mentioned, wealthy people. Not many of you were noble, of noble birth. We'll read about that, but that means some of you were of noble birth. So there were noble, there were wealthy, there were influential, and we know there were slaves there. Corinth was also known for its different religions and temples and its religious pilgrims, and because of that, it was very much a major tourist attraction. Now, this is, you're going to have to kind of wrap your brain around this. So this is all these people knew. They grew up with this. This is, you know, Ryan, I see you back there. This is what you raise your family. This is what your dad did. This is what we do. There's six major temples to different gods, Roman and Greek gods there in Corinth. And so these were the main places of worship and temple worship. There were 26 sacred places and shrines devoted to other gods in Corinth. So I'm telling you, there were just gods everywhere. And it's a god of your choosing, whoever you wanted to worship, you could, and you could do it without any judgment. So if you want to worship Apollos, go for it. If you want to worship Aphrodite, go for it. If you want to worship Hercules or Heracles, you go for it. You know what? More power to you. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. So it was kind of like that. It was just kind of a real potpourri, so to speak, of religions. Now, one of the temples, I'll mention a couple of them. One of the temples was the temple of Apollo, which is a Roman god. I think I have a picture of that. This is the temple of Apollo here. This thing used to be massive. It used to have 15 columns on one side, six across. And so this would be the center point, really, of the Roman Forum, the temple of Apollo. And Apollo is a Roman god. This is the Acrocorinth. And this right up here we'll talk about in a few minutes is where probably one of the most notorious, I would say, or interesting places. The temple to Aphrodite was up there. That's called the Acrocorinth there. But this big place here was the temple to Apollo. And when Paul was there, this thing was beautifully built. The temple to Aphrodite was beautiful built, so beautifully built. Also had the temple to, I can't hardly say this, Asclepius, the god of physical, emotional, and mental healing. And so they had they worshiped at this temple there, and part of the temple was a spa, part of the temple was a bath, part of the temple was a hospital. I was thinking, just like Houston, we have the Med Center. But it was the temple of Asclepius. I can't say it very well, but it was a hospital and it was a health resort. Also had temples for emperor worship, because you really had to worship Rome and Caesar if you wanted to make it as a Roman. Also places to worship Hermes and Poseidon and Athena and many, many others. But let me ask you a question. What would Paul call shrines and sacred places and these gods that they're worshiping. What would he call them? Idols. So when we read 1 Corinthians, all he's talking about there is these very places that, you know, somehow they're like mythicalized now in our minds, the Greek gods and all that. This was how they raised their kids. This is who they worshiped. So it was full of idols and shrines and sacred places that people worshiped. Sixth is this. My last point on Corinth is this. Corinth was synonymous with sexual promiscuity. It was synonymous. The temple of Aphrodite, I don't want to go into any great detail on this, but she was the Greek goddess of pleasure, love, beauty, passion, and fertility. At one time, some people think that there were up to 1,000 temple prostitutes called sacred shrine prostitutes. Think about that. Sacred shrine prostitutes, male and female, whatever you want. And sexual immorality was a part of worshiping Aphrodite. Immorality, think about this now. Think about raising kids where immorality and religion and worship go hand in hand. That's all they knew. This is the way they were raised. All that promiscuity and immorality not only took place in the temple of Aphrodite, but it also spilled out into the whole city. And you can imagine travelers who could be anonymous, sailors who were waiting for ships to be unloaded. It was a pretty kind of crazy place. People would travel to Corinth just to indulge and experience the lifestyle that was there in Corinth. Corinth was synonymous with sexual immorality. It was synonymous with no judgment. You could indulge in anything you wanted to in Corinth anonymously, and nobody was going to say anything about it. So, you know, the analogy there has to be to Sin City here in the United States, which would be Las Vegas of the ancient world. What happens in Corinth stays in Corinth, basically. Tell you an interesting thing. There's actually a verb from the Latin, I think it is. It's called to Corinthianize. And you know what Corinthianize is? I think we have it up here. Do we have that? Maybe we didn't do it. But to Corinthianize means to live a promiscuous life, to live a sensual life, or to live a self-indulgent life. So that's the culture of Corinth. That's the very culture and the environment that these Corinthian Christians came out of. They were saved from this very culture right here. And I think about that. They came out of that lifestyle, 40 to 100 people out of 100,000 people. Now that would take some gumption to stand up and say, okay, now I believe in this man Jesus, and I believe that this guy Paul tells us the truth. And of course, it was confirmed, I'm sure, with signs and miracles. But think about 40 to 100 people out of 100,000 people embracing this message and living out this new faith and this new lifestyle, all the while having to get rid of the old life. How many of you know that's sometimes difficult to do? And how many of you know when you live in the old life, close to the old life, there's always a temptation to go back to it? So I'm not giving them a free pass on what they did here in 1 Corinthians, but I am letting you know that if you or I were there, it may not have been much different for us. So, you know, it was practically for us, though. I wanted to leave on a good note tonight. Practically, I wanted to talk about this. How many of you are glad that God takes imperfect people from imperfect backgrounds? You know what? We may not have been pagan backgrounds, but you know what? We were lost in our sins and dead in our trespasses. So, you know, he takes imperfect people from all sorts of far from perfect backgrounds, and then he makes us into new people. Now, how many of you know he doesn't make us into new people immediately? It's a process. You know, we come out of our old way of life and we embrace this new way of living and we begin to change, and then it doesn't happen immediately, and then we fall or we take a step backwards, and then somebody encourages us to get back up and we start taking more steps. And you know what? We make mistakes. We have to be corrected. But how many of you know God is patient with us? He doesn't give up on us. And as long as we are willing, he will continue to mold us and make us into who he wants us to be. Doesn't matter what you've come out of, you know what? God has a good future for you. Amen. So the second thing I want to end on is this. He then puts us into a community of believers called the church. And how many of you know churches are not perfect? This church wasn't perfect. Lakewood's not perfect. It's close, but it's not perfect. But because churches are full of imperfect people. And the other thing is, you know, churches, growing churches, are full of people that are new to the faith and they're learning and still in process. And so there's going to be some fireworks in churches that are taking people. They're going to make mistakes. There's going to be sexual immorality. There's going to be factions. You know what? But that's the whole part of, you know, growing people up so that they can grow in their knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. I wrote down here that churches can be messy, but God uses the church to help us grow and to become everything that He wants us to be. Amen? So, you know what? That's just a broad brushstroke of that's who the Corinthians were. Next week, we're going to dive into the first chapter of the book of Corinthians. We're going to dive into some of the real issues that they were dealing with. Paul does not mince words, so we're going to have to not mince words as he teaches us. Amen? Did you enjoy that tonight? I hope it wasn't too much of a history lesson. All right, so if you could, next week, if you could read 1 Corinthians 1, and if you could read it in several different translations like the Passion or the NIV or the Message Bible, it would be great. Amen. Father, dismiss us with your blessings. Thank you for your goodness to us. Lord, guide us and direct us as we travel home. Give us traveling mercies. Be with our families that are not here, Father. Father, just be with our church family, Father. Be with Joel, Victoria. Father, be with our online family that are watching, people watching from all over the world, Father. Be with us. Dismiss us with your blessings in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless.